spirit, pride, commitment. The story of the St. Peter's College First 15 in 2000. After some friendly matches and trial games, the Auckland competition began in earnest. First, De La Salle beaten 37 points to 11. Then Mount Albert Grammar, 30 points to 15. Tamaki College, 54 points to 6. St. Kentigan's narrowly, 16-15. Otahuhu College, 33 points to 8. St. Paul's College, 18 points to nil. And then King's College, 28 points to 8. Then the first game against Kelston, last year's national champions. This promised to be a tough game, and it was at the cage. On their home track and urged on by the St. Peter's army of support, it wasn't long before the first points were posted. St. Peter's in the dark blue had a real point to prove against the former champion side. And when the huge prop, Sawani Tongaohia, number one, surged towards the line, a power play was on. Keep your eye on number six, Mace Polloy, from this lineout. In the finish, it was pretty easy as he dived through a big hole, 5-0 St. Peter's. Chris Merrick adds the two for a 7-0 lead. Ray Isara, a member of last year's winning national side, shows sweet skills, but the St. Peter's defence is one of the best in the competition. Kelston bluster up to the 10-metre line, but man-to-man is excellent. Just as they get within reach, St. Peter's in fringe, Kelston in a very handy spot. Ray Isara doesn't miss these. Kelston pressured the St. Peter's line, and 5 metres out, this forward combination is quite awesome. The points to Kelston this time to Tafui Halaholo, the hooker. Relentless forward pressure and Halaholo's strength did it in the finish. Isara from wide out, and it's Kelston 10-7. Kelston now put the squeeze on St. Peter's, and their hold at the top of the table spot was looking a little shaky with Kelston moves like this. Ryan Kane had subbed for the injured halfback, and he set the line alight with 15 Isara showing his best form. Only a metre short, and chalked that up to St. Peter's tackling. Isara put Kelston further ahead. It's 13-7. Second half, and Ray Isara is about to sustain what looks to be a fairly serious-looking leg injury. As we can see in the replay, he went down pretty awkwardly and he had to leave the paddock. But Isara, one of the star players for Kelston, would return and have a big bearing on the game. Chris Merrick kept St. Peter's in touch with this penalty. 13-10 to Calster. Now, the great one. Kane Hansey simply stepped inside halfback in first five and had the pace to finish. It's now St. Peter's 15-13 with a kick to come. Merrick again. It's 17-13. St. Peter's have got the lead back. Asara at the other end. 17-16 St. Peter's. Now St. Peter's were taking it to Kelston, threatening their line several times. Dead-eye Merrick put the home side further ahead at St. Peter's 20-16. Moments later, he did it again, 23-16 to St. Peter's. Calston aren't one of New Zealand's best sides just on paper. They deliver, and at injury time, they mount their final assault. The ball swings left and right in the mouth of the St. Peter's posts. Ryan Kane doing great work at half, but St. Peter's hold. Only a metre short and Calston are playing huge rugby. A kick won't do it. Watch that Kelston number 8, Sione Lauaki. It's 21-23 with the kick to come. Asara obliges at 23-all. Deep into injury time, the last gasp. A draw will do for St. Peter's to stay top, but they need that win. And Calston nearly stuff it up. So the game ends. Calston think they've won, but the scoreboard says 23-all. The Auckland competition is like that. Next, St. Peter's beat Avondale College 69-7 in a one-sided game, but their next matchup was against the Mowasca Cup holders, Auckland Grammar.
Well, the Mowasca Cup's on the line. It's a tough one for you. Auckland Grammar, top of the competition.
Yes, well, they're right at the top there with us.
And of course,
and we're looking forward to the battle.
Yeah. 300 yards up the road from St Peter's, that's where Grammar is, but they're on their home patch. That'll be tough for you.
Well, strangely enough, Grammar, we actually have more success on their field than on our own. We've only ever beaten them once on our own ground back in 1987 in the days of Pat Lamb.
Really?
Yes.
So you don't have any fears going up to the...
Not at all. We look forward to it.
Much the same team as the one that drew with Kelston?
Yeah, virtually the same team, yes. One or two changes, but nothing very much.
After 5 minutes, the accurate Chris Merrick puts St Peter's ahead. Ben Artinga replied for Auckland Grammar at the other end, 3-3 after 12 minutes. Auckland Grammar, playing in an alternate white strip, about to make a costly mistake. St Peter's half, Kane Hansey, is all bustle as he unloads to Jeffrey Hiromi, and it's a classic kick and chase. Nick Lydiard is wonderful in defence, but that's short-lived. From their handy launching platform, the big St Peter's number one, Tonga Uahia, does the graft, and Brendan Tupou-Vea scores unopposed from the roll-around. The kick is not converted. It's St Peter's 8-3. Grammar scored from another penalty, and at 8-6 were definitely on the back foot, as St Peter's went again and again, this time with great profit. A classic wide-out try to Tom Latu. Great hands, running good lines, and the timing of the pass, the fundamentals done so well. St Peter's 13-6, the try unconverted. St Peter's went further ahead in the second half for a 16-6 scoreline, but then it's Grammar's show. Huge line-out jumping by Roko Babich sets the scene for a pushover five-pointer. With the extras, it's St Peter's lead cut to 3 at 16-13. Auckland Grammar mount one last attack with time up. Just look at St Peter's mustered forces out wide as Grammar go again. And with the line beckoning, a misdirected pass, and it's all over. St. Peter's have won the Mwaska Cup 16-13.
Look at that cup!
Just on behalf of the Grammar Toys, coaches,
management and all our supporters, I'd like to welcome St. Peter's Fist 15, all their supporters. Thank you very much. Today's game was very physical. It surely shows why you guys are on top. Wish you all the best for your last game and into the finals. Look after the cup. Yeah, thanks.
On behalf of our boys Gimel and our school, as you can see them, I'd like to congratulate you guys on your effort out there. You guys are awesome. You know, you guys gave it in, never gave up until the end, and I must recommend you on that. You guys will be there in the finals, and I hope to see you guys there. To our boys, done it boys, coming to the end of the season, up top, we proved that we wanted to be on top. And that with all our hearts together joined as one, we won it today, boys. To our supporters, we've done it for you.
Two more games. They beat Onehunga High 39 points to 17 and Sacred Heart in a close game 14 points to 11. Semi-final time in the Auckland competition and their second matchup against Kelston, again at the cage.
This is our last obstacle before our goal, eh boys? We all know that our goal was to make the finals, eh boys? This is it, eh? Last obstacle, eh? Last mountain to climb, eh boys? This is it, eh?
No one hides, man. Watch the game. No one hides. You shouldn't be hiding behind someone's back. Put your hand up.
Everything we've done this year, don't mean shit, eh? This game here, come down to this game here, eh?
Facts, when we get the forward, we do something with it, man. The forwards are doing all the grunt work. The key, we do something with it.
All the training we've done this week, all the hard training. You guys know all the training you guys put in, eh? Extra runs in there, you've done, eh? So it comes down to this game, to put everything into this game, eh?
The game is only 3 minutes old and St. Peter's have the lead. The impetus comes from number one, Sawane Tongahia. Kelston are good on the open side. No way through there. Hensie can't find clear space on the short side either. Then Tongahiva gets going. Raw power, 5-0 St. Peter's. The New Zealand secondary school's rep lives up to his reputation. Seven minutes gone, and we're about to see how this game was about to shape up. The legendary strong running Kelston backline penetrates over halfway, but St. Peter's were indeed putting their hand up when it counted. Fierce, rugged tackling was holding out the red tide. Only 10 metres out, looking good for Kelston. Kelston number 15, Ray Asara, is buried by Jeffrey Irani. Merrick's kick bounces awkwardly for Kelston, and a slip and a tumble sees a wall of blue in Kelston's half. Then Kelston break left and a try seems on. Hensie denies Aboa's kick ahead. Yeah! A beautiful take by Alvar, and the drive is on a metre short. Level pegging, it's 5-all. St. Peter's, camped in the Kelston 22. Hansey pilfers the ball. Again Hansey goes. Not over the advantage line yet. Jeffrey Aromi cuts back towards the forwards. Then in the fourth phase, there's number 11, Edward Asatasi. Kawaini Tongahiva sets the stage. Hansi to Asatasi, it's 10-5. Merrick from wide out, 12-5 St. Peter's. That's Auckland Grammar in the background, where at the same time as this game, Grammar are playing St. Kent against in the other semi-final. Storm clouds are gathering too. Waimata Tupou gets almost to the 10 metres, St. Peter's. Kelston bustle to mid 22, 10 metre line. Ryan Kane gets a half gap and unloads beautifully to Asara. This is his moment of the day. Done by the bounce. Kelston were back though by 2 points down, 10 to 12. Isara completes the scoring with two more. It's 12-all. From the dropout, first it's the big man, Tongahiva, then 13, Fono Moana. Tongahiva draws the tackle off Merrick, but he puts the ball down with the line open. Mace Palloy, number 8, makes about 15 metres, and for a moment, Kelston's defence is ragged. Asatasi, the dive, but half a metre short. Held up, 5 metre scrum. The rain thrashes down, but the handling is great, with Merrick nearly through. Quick hands, and this time, Asatasi makes the ground on the right wing. The long pass from Pone Moana gives the pacey Asatasi the room wide. It's St. Peter's, 17-12. 30 minutes gone, and this is one of those beautifully constructed tries. First, the good line-out possession. Then the clean feed for the back line. Asatasi in space. Tom Latu does the rest. The ability for the speedy backs to beat a man on the outside. Timing of the pass, the classic finish. 22-12 to St. Peter's. Time up in the first half. 6 tries already. Put this one in the annals of St. Peter's great ones. This is an action replay of the one we've just seen. It doesn't look much at this stage, but when Tongahiva gets wound up, he does remind you of a very famous All Black, doesn't he? Aromi steams into space, and what a pass to Asatasi, and Latu is on hand. Kelston short of numbers, Aromi's super pass, and what about Latu's hands with a wet ball? It's 27-12 St. Peter's. Kelston might be 15 points down, but they have 30 minutes to get the game back, and their half-time prep talk from coach Bruce Cunningham goads them into action. That's the St. Peter's 22. Kelston are finding the St. Peter's tackling resolute, to say the least. Referee Glenn Wallstrom signals hands in there, and Reyesara steps to the mark. St. Peter's still well in front though, 27-15. Chris Merrick takes the shot. From the mark, Kelston realised that only 7 pointers will get them back in the game. St. Peter's shut them down early. Things are looking promising when Fono Maiwana steps into the gap and dots down easy. Fono Maiwana timed that to perfection. Good hands, and St. Peter's look comfortable at 32-15. Kelston have seen their berth in the final slipping away, but they're gutsing it out. DJ Forbes pushes through some weak tackles. Only a metre short, and Kelston want to end this in style. A penalty right under the bar. John Senio is held up, centimetres short, 5 metres scrum. Three minutes gone, second half, and Kelston get the consolation try. So with 2 minutes to go, it's 32-20 to St. Peter's. Isara can't miss from this range. It's 32-22. Time is up, but hang on to your hats, folks. The scoreboard's about to change. Watch St. Peter's halfback number 9, Kane Hansen. Hansi has the knack of being in the right place at the right time. He had plenty of work to do, though, from inside his own half, and the speedsters were after him. That's the deal, though. St. Peter's unbeatable at 37-22. Merrick tries the drop. The ball is dead. The game is over. St. Peter's will go to the final, knocking out last year's national champions in a 10-try spectacular. A huge disappointment for a great side, Kelston, beaten today by a better team. The different attitudes after the game say it all. St. Peter's have dug deep week after week since the competition began in May, and they thoroughly deserve their title shot.
Can't complain. I think it's an excellent rugby. Conditions. Played the conditions, and it's a great game. Beautiful choice.
Yeah, that was what I was going to say. Rain swept the ground a few times, but your guys' handling was great.
Yep. Just that's all we do at training. Concentrate on ball skills and maintain the ball and enjoy ourselves.
Your boys look ready, fit, and they really were hungry for that one.
Well, I think we owe Kelson a few. In the few years I've been here, we've always been the receiving end from Kelson, so it's about time we give him one back.
Eric, you're into a final. I mean, that was a tough game today. A week later, you're in a final, so you're up there.
Well, we'll be trying hard. We respect every team we've played this year, and no doubt we'll respect whoever wins out of Grammar or St. Kent's, so we'll be there trying again next week.
And so on to the Auckland final at Eden Park. St. Peter's had narrowly beaten St. Kentigan 16-15 in the pool play. Now their second matchup for the Auckland title. St. Peter's Chris Merrick gets the Auckland final underway. These two teams have fought out the toughest competition in New Zealand secondary schools rugby, and both fully deserve to be here. Early touches. First, Sam Whiteman doesn't find touch. Then Tom Latu misses with his response. Ofa Takai decides to run on a perfect playing surface and makes good meters too. Ryan Ferguson delicately chips in behind. Now the first sight of the big St. Peter's prop, Sawane Tangihiva. Captain Jeffrey Iramy kicks deep behind the St. Kent's line, and Sam Whiteman is snaffled. Just 2.5 minutes gone, and the war drums speak. It's St. Kent's on attack. Free kick to St. Peter's, and they believe they have the firepower to run it out from this position. Merrick's kick in behind again, Foot's return, and play is seesawing up and down the field. Then Tom Latu misjudges this one slightly, with disastrous consequences for St. Peter's. Ferguson runs right with not a lot on. That is, until Joe Rocococo gets the ball. Ofa Takai speeds on. Carl Stevens the pass. James Foot, 5 points. Joe Rocococo, a New Zealand rep with a sidestep a mile wide. Then ably supported by Takai, Stevens, and Foot is the scorer with Hansey in hot pursuit. Unconverted, it's 5-0 St. Kennigan. Rocococo, not this time. St. Peter's battling over halfway. St. Kentigans draw the penalty for not staying on their feet. Another New Zealand rep, Chris Merrick. A blatant, not straight, advantage St. Kentigan. Great moments in finals are made from situations like this. St. Kent's ball, 8 metres inside their half, then it happens. The halfback fumble. Lucky Leota onto it in a flash, and Kane Hansey has the legs. Merrick from the 22. From the drop ad, Ofa Takai takes and shows good skills. The advantage turns to a penalty right where and when St. Kent's need it. Ferguson with the kick. St. Kendigan's press, that's the goal line. Short side, and Eugene Benneker goes in with St. Peter's looking on. St. Peter's calmly disciplined in spite of being 3 points down. First the drive up the short side. Then in a tight spot at second five. Tongahiva has a barge. Peniamina makes 2 metres. Then number 8, Mace Palloy, is in the action. Despite a protesting Sam Whiteman, Mace Palloy is awarded the 5-pointer, and now it's all on. Chris Merrick. Only moments to go now, and a try for St. Kent's will do it. St. Peter's sole responsibility is to retain possession. Merrick's kick doesn't go out, and just a hint for St. Kent's. Foot mugged on halfway. St. Kent's have the ball, or do they? What a vital turnover. More good news for St. Kent's. Whiteman through the half gap, but Merrick just nabs him. The penalty is awarded, and for a second, St. Kent's think they have it. When St. Peter's get the ball back, Tongahiva just doesn't want to let it go. Merrick has the last second responsibility. Unbeaten all season, and now the Auckland 1A Championship. Well done, St. Peter's.
St. Kent's had their chances, we had ours, we grabbed ours.
I thought in the last five you might have blown it. They had a lot of ball.
Yeah, too many balls are out, but I don't know, we've been great all year for our defence. That's what sort of kept us in the competition all year, just through our defence.
Eric, what did you think when you were five down after about 2 or 3 minutes? That was an opening burst. You know, did you think you had it? You were right up against it, or what were your thoughts?
No, my boys didn't play well at all. The first half, if we look at the tape later on, we didn't play well at all in the first half. We sort of stand back and let St. Kins dictate to us. So in the second half there, earlier on, we sort of cut back into them and go a bit harder ourselves. And that was resulted in a try by the number eight going right through the ruck. And
right
that's what's supposed to be to happen all the time, but it happened.
What's the story with the boys now? You're under the 32, you're in that, so what do they do from now on?
Look, to be honest, I haven't thought about it. I was wanting to get this weekend over. Next weekend, the boys are away for the Northern Region. We've got five boys in the Northern Region. And then, I think it's the 1st of September, I believe, it's the first game, so I've just got to wait and see. But we're going to have a rest this week.
Well, you deserve it. Go well.
Thanks very much.
It's into the final 32 of the national competition. First up, the visitors, Hauraki Plains. There was an element of the David and Goliath about this match, and when only 4 minutes had elapsed, Kane Hansey, normally the St. Peter's halfback but today playing first five, delayed his pass, cruised through the gap, and fed a bullet pass to Eddie Asatasi for his try number one. Even without their powerhouse Sawane Tongihiva, St. Peter's have all the forward physique they require. Captain Aromi makes pace over the 22. Out left where 15 Tom Latu cuts back towards the posts. Peniamina number 3 buffets towards the goal line and it seems to be stalling until Arome's long pass puts Asatasi on the outside for his second try. Points mounting against Hauraki, but occasionally in the first half, they had some very good moments. St. Peter's lucky to escape from this one. Hauraki Plains would appear to have the advantage from their throw-in, but all season St. Peter's have countered the best sides with swarming defence. What looks like contained isn't, and Asatasi heads for try number 3 and 15-0. Again, Hauraki Plains on attack. Again, they appear to have the upper hand until Hansey bursts clear. Who's on the end of the pass? Eddie Asatasi for 20-0. St. Peter's leading 22-0 into the second half, and now with the wind, the floodgates are unleashed. It looked like a fumble, but ruled okay. The forwards thrust for the line, and it nearly works. Some clever interplay, and Tom Latu has another. It's 27-0. Regular Chris Merrick is out injured, so Aromi is doing the kicking. This one goes over. This time, Hansi uses the following wind to good effect. And again, Hauraki Plains are on the back foot. A good bounce puts Aromi into position to feed Adam Elwood. It's Joe Plamis that claims the try. It's 34-0, 10 minutes into the second half. Number two, Gerardo Purcell, trundles towards the line. And when Tupavia is held up, Joe Plamis on the right wing gets his second. Look at the control and confidence that St. Peter's show. Latu providing the overlap for Asatasi's fifth. Hansi was having an armchair right at first five and is about to score one of the better tries of the day. First, he grubbers through, and when the Hauraki Plains defenders failed to gather, he picks up and grubbers again and scores another beauty. By the way, that's his mother in the white top. At 49-0, Hauraki were now playing to keep the score reasonable, but St. Peter's had other ideas. Asatasi screams through the gap, and try number six looks certain, but this time he's scragged. Aromi carries on, Hauraki are back in numbers. The handoff from halfback Taike Apu, and number three, Graham Dew, goes on the score sheet. It's 54-0. Minutes gone and still plenty of time for more points. Todd Hewitt breaks some tackles, and a nice pass gives Asatasi another one. He's got six. From the kick out, and St. Peter's were going into cruise mode. Over the 10 metres, players to burn on the right, the loop around, and Aromi gives Todd Hewitt plenty of open space. Two minutes remain, the score is 63-0, and one final burst. Aromi again busts the line, this time missing out Hewitt for the fast finishing Tohu Hawk. Hauraki Plains' big day out will not be one they remember too fondly, but this is the nature of this competition. It's tough at the top. St. Peter's, winning easily, and looking formidable at 71-0. Unfortunately, Hamilton boys, who were the next opponents in the final 16 competition, defaulted, and St. Peter's crossed the bridge to meet North Shore's Westlake boys in the quarterfinal. Westlake kick off on a perfect day with the breeze blowing across the field, so giving no real advantage. Immediately, Mace Polloy drops the ball, which gives everyone on the Westlake bank something to cheer about. Hansey combines with Plamis, but the kick's charged by Andrew Gowley. The first sight of the big man, Sawane Tongawiha, but they know how potentially dangerous he is, and over he goes. From the kickoff, St. Peter's are already looking dangerous, and the man Westlake really need to watch, Eddie Asatasi, moose freely. After 2 minutes, Merrick puts St. Peter's ahead, a penalty to nothing, then St. Peter's strike. First, the forward surge to get Westlake moving backwards. Now along the chain, and who's there? The top try scorer, number 11, Eddie Asatasi. Just look at the balance of this guy. His outside swerve has to be the best at this level of rugby. It's 8-0 to St. Peter's. Twenty minutes later, the scoreboard ticks over again. Asatasi provides the thrust from the left wing, and Captain Jeffrey Yoromi gets 5 points. Merrick holds it nicely for Asatasi, and the goal line is only 10 metres away. The try is not converted, so St. Peter's go to the break at 13 points to nil. Eight minutes into the second half, and Westlake open their account. The scrum on the St. Peter's 22 gives good ball for the backs, but they almost throw it away. Playing an advantage, Westlake drive on. The Westlake back line is covered, but Jason Campbell manages a kick through. When it deflects off a St. Peter's player, there's fullback Sam Slater. Stainton was hungry for work, and when the ball appeared in front of him, he was moving at pace for a beauty just by the posts. 13-5 St. Peter's. McAllister goals, 13-7 St. Peter's. But the big, heavy St. Peter's packs was taking its toll. Asatasi looks to have a real chance on the left, but he's stopped. Number three, Zachariah Peniamina, barges a meter or so. Hansey fires to Asatasi again. Tongawiha almost gets there. Jeffrey Yoromi does. Tongawiha's awesome power was proving a real handful, and Yoromi gets his second. It's 18-7 to St. Peter's. Despite a very noisy Westlake crowd, Merrick adds 2 points. It's 20 points to 7. Another sustained attack. St. Peter's had camped inside the Westlake 22. Westlake were desperate in defence, but the dark blue wall surged forward again and again. Hansey gives it to Tonga Weha, but 3-on-1 get him. Only centimetres short, Hansey looks, then goes himself. It's been a remarkable season for the gutsy little halfback Kane Hansey. That's not over yet. Tries at vital times have stamped his mark on St. Peter's history. Merrick goals, it's 27-7 to St. Peter's, and it's game's end. The Auckland regional champions have now earned themselves a trip to Dunedin, and on current form, they will be very, very hard to beat.
Jeffrey, another tough game on top of all the others you've had this season.
Yes, indeed we have. It's been a tough season for us. But our boys have surely fought every game, you know, with their hearts.
I look back to the Moesca Cup. That was a tough game, did you know, and they've just built from there and got harder and harder. And, mate, you haven't finished yet.
We got a sort of a motivational thing. We use our SPC, Spirit, Pride, Commitment, and it's just there. We build on every week. We build up, taking each step, you know, taking each game, never thinking about the ahead, never thinking ahead. Yeah.
Well, you know, I mean, you won the Auckland title, now you've won against, so you're in the final four, you're on your way to Dunedin, so that's a big thrill for you guys, you know.
Yeah, I'll be stoked with my boys, eh? I've worked hard and it's about time they've been, being congratulated or something, and a good trip down to Dunedin and a few more hard games. Yeah. They'll be looking forward to it.
Well, and that's been interrupted. Of course, guys like yourself have been selected in the secondary schools and the New Zealand team, you know. Yeah. So, I don't know, you must have played nearly 30 games this season.
Yeah, it's been a hard season, been a long season, especially when you're making rep teams and New Zealand sides, travelling around.
Do you have any time for schoolwork?
On trips you've got to take
All
your
right. And,
yeah.
Okay.
So on to Dunedin for the semi-final against, this time, Gisborne Boys. St. Peter's were up 2-0 when Gisborne mounted an attack. Met by solid defence, Gisborne probed the short side, but a determined Leota rips the ball for the turnover and Hansey punts downfield. Daniel Cornwell and Nathan Horry try to stop the flow, but Elwood is there to free up Jeff Yaromi. That's 11 points to nil, St. Peter's. The throwing and catching combination of Gerardo Purcell and Brendan Tupavia launched St. Peter's on another downfield raid. Interplay between Merrick and Yaromi to the 22, where Elwood continues. Tonga Weha bursts 5 metres. Merrick straightens and the goal line is getting really close. Hansey to Tonga Weha, further left, and Asatasi provides the finish. Now 16-0 St. Peter's. The second half in scoring terms belonged to Gisborne. Number 2, Joe Duffy, out on the left, will feature again very shortly. A good overlap has Cornwall in a handy position. Toby Duckworth straightens and Gisborne are in the zone. Duffy takes the short pass. It's 16-5. Gisborne added a penalty to make it 16-8 St Peter's, then a bizarre incident. Asatasi is clear and away down the left, but is ruled to have knocked the ball on when diving for a certain try. The replay reveals the touch judge and the referee got it dead right. The ball was grounded before the goal line and was in fact a knock-on. No try by St Peter's, who win anyway, 16-8. Now the final of the National Secondary Schools Competition at Carisbrook and Dunedin. After a long and successful season, St Peter's came up against Wellington College.
Well, it all began with 64 teams contesting a knockout style format, with the real competition starting at the final 32 stage. At that point, St Peter's moved into top gear. There was a default in there as well, but they carried on from there. And in Thursday's semi-final, a 16-8 win over Gisborne Boys saw them through. Wellington College, also highly impressive, and coming from behind on Thursday to beat Otago Boys in the semi-finals. So it's St Peter's against Wellington for the Adidas Schools Championship in the year 2000. And some pretty useful players in here as well. Viewers over the years will have seen Jeffrey Yeromi in midfield at New Zealand secondary school level, and a magnificent front row weighing in heavier than the All Black front row, led by Sione Tongawea, who is an impressive 130 kgs in weight. Wellington College proudly wearing their caps, those who have been awarded them. Some very fine players here as well. And today, look to Andrew Jacobson, a very mobile loosehead prop, and Brent Maresi, who kicked brilliantly in trying conditions from first 5-8 on Thursday. Then set down by Wellington College, and interestingly there will be no reply from St Peter's. Mark Goodhue, this afternoon's referee, and I'm sure an experience, Greg Cooper, that he will enjoy as well. You don't get much better standard of play than what we're going to see over the next 80 minutes.
Well, schoolboy rugby over the years has always been entertaining, exciting, and yes, for the referee, this will be a big match. For these players, a big match, a chance to be seen on the national stage, on television, live television here on Sky Sport, and I'm sure there'll be a lot of people around the country, particularly from the schools, and those who know all these players, be watching this match with interest. A big day in the careers of these young rugby players.
All set, blank skipper. Okay, let's go.
So the game underway. Chris Merrick, pretty useful first 5-8 from St Peter's, kicking us into action at Carisbrook, the Adidas top four final in the year 2000, and a useful reply from Wellington College. Greg, we were just remarking off air, you don't often see a haka led by a winger.
No, that's right, but also just the eyes that gave it away, didn't they? The passion was there. We see it with the All Blacks, and these young players no doubt look at the All Blacks and say, one day I want to be there, and they certainly gave the haka everything it deserved. A lot of passion, a lot of commitment.
Ball being a little untidily addressed there by Wellington College, who have been penalised by the referee. In fact, perhaps the first shot of the afternoon. We saw in Thursday's semi-final in windy conditions at Tahuna Park, Brent Moresi kicking brilliantly for Wellington, and Chris Merrick equally as impressive for St Peter's. So the kickers will certainly play a major part this afternoon.
I think it was Ross Kennedy, the man from Wellington College, just penalised for coming across and pulling down on the opposition jumper. And yes, a big goal here attempted by Chris Merrick, 40-odd metres out with the angle. No wind at all to speak of at present.
Kicked a couple of penalties in the 16-8 win over Gisborne Boys on Thursday. Distance is going to be a problem for him. Didn't really strike it all that well, but it may turn out to be a fairly useful kick with St Peter's chasing it up, but they've burst away through what have Wellington College, and a big kick downfield. Now we might see a few of the big boys into action as the kick comes through from Jeremy Aromi, and back to take the mark is Simon Allen.
On the five.
So just reiterating the pathway for these teams through to the final today. St Peter's beating Gisborne 16-8 after leading 16-0 at half-time, and Wellington College coming from behind twice to beat Otago Boys 24-21. As Wellington drive it up, and St Peter's drive it up through Yoromi. Glorious conditions here in Dunedin. And the big boys start warming to their task. Mace Pulloin. Away they go again, looking to close in on the 22 of Wellington College. Utilising the blind side. Yoromi taken down in a good tackle by Jacobson. This is good, solid play from St Peter's. But there's a turnover and a chance for Wellington to relieve the pressure. Well, they did have the opportunity, the ball being lost by Allen. There's a chance for a try. Yes! The first try of the afternoon to Chris Merrick. I don't think he could believe his luck, but he certainly followed through. And good reward for tracking the ball. The opening points to Chris Merrick.
Well, I was just going to mention there, if the play had stopped, that we are seeing the ability or the generalship from, I suppose, Eric Kalassi, the coach of St Peter's, a well-known Auckland identity in rugby circles with the Maris Club up there. He's just keeping it nice and close, the St Peter's side, and putting the pressure on to Wellington College. And Merrick was the man who was able to dive on the ball and score a try. But St Peter's just keeping it close, using their big men up front, and just keeping it, not trying to get too adventurous and get wide, and the opportunity came. A great start for St Peter's early in the match.
Chance for Merrick to convert his own try. Didn't hit his first attempt all that well. That looks a little better. It's a vast improvement. 7 points to Chris Merrick and 7 for his team. And that's an apt number here. Later on in the afternoon, we'll celebrate Josh Cronfeld's last match and his beloved number 7. And here it comes from the mistake, Greg, and poor Allen, who looked so assured in the first 4 or 5 minutes, rather fell to pieces there. Brent Moresi sends it towards the posts, and that's a useful first up effort from the first 5-8, and he drags 3 points back for his team. Thrown in by Purcell and grabbed at the second plate from Elwood. Deep inside Wellington's 22. St Peter's looking to rumble, but they're crabbing sideways. Now they straighten it up. The big boys looking to get their hands on it. Tongawea, he lays it back. Hansi to Merrick. Merrick looking to run Yoromi in. Good tackle by Kerrison for Wellington, but St. Peter's get it again, and it's Asatasi! Edwin Asatasi, he scored a lot of tries for his St. Peter's team this year. That'll be one he remembers.
Well, that was clinical, wasn't it, Steve? It was taken off the top. It was driven, dragging in the fringe defenders of Wellington College, playing to the strength and going blindside here. And Asatasi with the fend. Should have been taken, but he's got speed. He's got a long reach with that fend. Got on the outside, but it is clever play from St. Peter's, playing to their strengths and utilising the ability that they have up front. The fend came in. The speed was there. Very good finish from Edwin Asatasi.
St. Peter's second try scored by Edwin Asatasi and presenting this conversion attempt from a handy angle.
Looks good.
For Merrick. And that's another one. Seven more for St. Peter's. They've doubled their tally and they lead 14-3. It's a loose head here to Wellington College. Not too many people in the ground this afternoon, Greg, but the St. Peter's College supporters certainly here in spirit. We understand that that banner, which has come south, has been signed by every pupil in the school.
Well, as I said before, Steve, I'm sure there'll be a lot of pupils, or most of the school will be watching, the schools from both, or pupils from both schools will be watching this match. A lot of interest.
Moresi looking to set something up onto Watt. Now, he's a runner, and he's got it away nicely to Allen, across to Patoa, and he's done well to present the ball to his forwards, who have arrived in sufficient numbers, moving close to the 22 of St. Peter's. Moresi, good surge from him. Forwards need to get there again quickly, and they've done well, but a little bit of accidental offside and a breakdown in communication. Really, with Guy Morris running into his own player, but better stuff from Wellington.
A lot better stuff, and you can see Moresi there just probing, trying to get in behind, using the having the ball in two hands. But I think it was Brendan Watt was the man that was run into, accidental offside.
Move it again. Up closer this time, please. Both sides folding in. Want to move closer, please.
We saw this front row in this morning's Otago Daily Times, Greg, heavier than the All Black front row. And you can see why. There's some big boys in there. 130, 103 and 118 kgs respectively, coming across from loose head to tight head. And I'm not sure that the Wellington College front row is that much smaller.
Well, that's right. There's some big boys in Wellington College as well. So it'll be interesting to see how the pace of the game takes its toll on these big men up front, because they certainly are very big indeed. Good scrum.
It was noticeable in the semi-final on Thursday that the St. Peter's, Wellington College team actually tired rather quickly. They got a second win late in the game, which was enough to get them home. So St. Peter's, I'm sure, will do everything they can to run them around. But here's one of the big boys who loves to run straight up the field. Sione Tongawea, and the ball presented nicely again for Merrick to go the aerial route. What? He takes it nicely, and he doesn't mind a run. Brendan Watt. Forwards have done well. The number eight, Guy Morris, takes it on again.
Off his foot, play on, ball's out.
Lindbergh. Andre Amato, who scored a try on Thursday. And the kick across field is easily picked off by Tohu Hawk, and almost gets around his man. Latu comes in from the back. 10-metre mark in St. Peter's territory. And a nice combination there between Hansey and Merrick. But Allen has it. Now his kick might just be a little too far. And it's shadowed back over the line by Chris Merrick. Throw from Purcell. Nicely dragged down by Jones. And Hansey is able to go to the year. It's not out, though. Taken just outside the 22 of St. Peter's. Nicely left there for Lindbergh. Referee's playing advantage. There's a good, incisive run from Alo. And the Wellington College carry on again. Chance for them here. Moresi, nice wide pass. The loose forwards out there in the form of Kerrison. Patoa's come across off his wing. And a turnover is forced, and Tongawea up towards the 22.
It's up.
Has the turnover been forced by Wellington? It has. Just getting a little scrappy. Inside the 22. The big number 8, Morris, takes it on. Little bit of confusion. Solid run from Tialata. Holds the ball nicely and leaves it there for his loose board, Kerrison. Referee playing advantage, so a penalty coming up. They may want to milk it. They may not. Allen couldn't quite get his pass away within 5. And the referee takes them back for a penalty right in front.
You're off your feet, Blue.
Oh, good refereeing there to allow that to go, because Wellington College, they had their chance. Yeromi did well just to make the tackle on Allen and then secure the ball. Look at this big hard run by Tialata. He's a big man as well. Good position. And that's where the penalty happened. Just going over the top, and quite rightly he was penalised. Yeromi comes in there, makes a tackle on his feet, gets the ball. Well done there, but the penalty went back in front of the post.
Some very mature players, both physically and mentally, in this game. All of these players, of course, under 19 on the 1st of January, as per the New Zealand Secondary Schools rulings. And I'm sure over the next 2 or 3 years, Greg, we'll see quite a number emerge on the first-class scene. It'll be interesting to follow their progress. The head-down style of Brent Maresi doubles Wellington's tally. So there's just an 8-point margin now. St. Peter's 14, Wellington College 6.
Hookers have got to find the mark. The ball might get slippery. So another factor comes in. Let's see how they control themselves with the rain.
Didn't look as though that throw went 5 metres, but play allowed to carry on from the ref. He's played some advantage, I think, to St. Peter's. They're away again. Yoromi. Picked up by Palloy. And stolen away by his opposite number, Guy Morris. Lindbergh, Maresi, and here go Wellington College. Good pass out to Watt. Useful fend, but there's no way his marker, Tohu Hawk, was going to let him go.
Actually, it's a great clash on this side, isn't it? With the Brendan Watt and Tohu Hawk. Watt getting through a lot of work, looking for work. It was a turnover here. Good play, just slightly crossfield, which probably didn't commit the defence. And, good defensive play by Hawk, staying on the inside and just shadowing his man out.
Nicely picked up by Maresi. He's an abrasive first 5-8. Doesn't mind mixing it, but he's lost the ball forward. The referee was playing advantage in the first instance. So within 5 of half-time now here at Carisbrook in the Adidas Top 4 Grand Final for the season. And it's St. Peter's leading Wellington 14 points to 6.
Grats and hold. Engage. It's good.
Maresi again testing the defence at the back, and it's just found a little wanting there. May have been turned over. Referee is playing advantage for a knock-on. Now here's a chance for Wellington. Maresi out to the big tight head prop, Tialata. Deep inside the 22, Wellington College now. Kennedy. Third phase possession. Oh, the big locks are doing the job. Allen out to Potua. And I'm not sure that was the right option. Trist grabbed again by Amato. Working well in combination. Maresi not able to get away from Elwood. Lindbergh. Tialata. Balls nicely. Kick from Alo. Now that's pretty useful. That could bounce nicely. Wasn't quite able to keep it in play, but a much better kick for Matthew Patoa. He's a little disappointed, but I think Wellington, Greg, will be reasonably happy at halftime.
I think so. Just looking at the match, the way it started, St. Peter's looked very good to start with. Big forwards controlling play, and they were shutting out this Wellington College side. But I just wonder, and you mentioned before fitness, interesting to see how Wellington College go into this match, because it looks as though they may have the better fitness. But certainly they are starting to get a bit of extra control back into the game that was missing because of the very good St. Peter's side at the start of the match.
So half-time at Carisbrook, St. Peter's from Auckland's North Shore leading Wellington College by 14 points to 6.
Yeah, we can can see it there. Look, the back line lined out the terrace side. Opportunity, wide space on the grandstand side. Great opportunity either way.
Stay on, you're offside here, playing advantage, blue half.
Well, here they go through their back line. Merrick, Maresi, able to make ground up towards the goal line of St. Peter's. Taking it on is Jacobson. Starting to mount some pressure here now, Wellington. Out to the big boy, Diolata. Referee playing advantage, and surely they must kick for goal here, Greg.
Yes, I think so, because they are controlling the game at present. And but nice to see a back line running as they did there, changing direction, and then just straightening it up. It was good play.
Right here.
Let's have a look here. You look at the first and second running, and then they just straighten. There's a change, and here it is here, just straight. Nice, like, that's good play. Very good play indeed, and a young back line to be operating like that. They must be well coached. And the penalty happened and was given right in front of the post. And yes, this is the right decision because of the fact if Wellington College was struggling in this in the game at present, will maybe not take the shot, but definitely I think they are going well. So try and take the 3 points and get it back to 14 points to 9.
And Greg, I must apologise to parents and supporters of St. Peter's in Auckland. Contrary to information we were fed earlier in the week, St. Peter's from Epsom, not on the north shore of Auckland.
Yes, it's a fine school in Auckland. A lot of good players have come from there. Pat Lamb was one of them. Bernie McCahill was another. Some very fine footballers have come out of St. Peter's College in Auckland.
As you would expect, 3 points for Brett Morrissey, and he has dragged Wellington just a little closer at 14 points to 9. You mentioned Pat Lamb. St. Peter's won this championship in 1987 when they beat Southland Boys, and I'm pretty sure Pat Lamb was captain on that occasion.
Yes, he's a real real icon in the St. Peter's school, as I said, as with Bernie McCahill, the great family, the McCahill family. And they'll be no doubt watching this match with interest.
St. Peter's clawing back from the kickoff, and they may be able to return in kind here.
You're on the wrong side, let it go.
Morris, the number 8, trapped, and they're not able to get out of the way, and the penalty presented to St. Peter's, and Merrick will look to drag those 3 points back. 14 points to 9. It's closing in here on a pretty intensive last 25 minutes.
Well, that's disappointing for Wellington College, just getting those 3 points back. The momentum was in their favour. You just see, yes, that is definitely a penalty. And a bit of tag pie, as they call it down here. And he wasn't letting go of the ball. So Merrick now with the opportunity just to peg those 3 points that they lost back in favour of St. Peter's College.
Yes, well, you couldn't blame Guy Morris. He was doing his job. He just got caught there, I guess. But here's the opportunity for Merrick. You can see just outside the 22 and about 14 in from touch. Handy angle. And he caresses it through for three more. For St. Peter's, Merrick now 12 points in the match. And the halftime margin is restored. It's 17-9, St. Peter's over Wellington.
Yeah, that's good. That's fine, we're playing on.
Throw for Purcell. Tongue away. Away again. Oh, he's got a nice pass off to his number 8, Mace Beloy. A little untidy.
Hands away.
But St. Peter's look to have control again. They do. Yeromi. Cutting a sway through, Jeffrey Aromi, getting it back into his tight head. Panayamina, 10-metre mark in Wellington College. The referee is playing advantage as the front row look to take control here. And the man penalised is Kurt Kerrison.
Off your feet.
What an imposing sight. See those fellows run.
I just got to say, when those big boys get going, they cause some damage, don't they? But it was Jeffrey Aromi who was the man who made the initial break. And here's Yeromi's run. Good, strong power there.
And
Naina was the man who carried it on.
Yep.
And then we see Tonga Weha. Well, yes, they are big indeed, and they do get past the tackle line, and that is what you need to do. Get past cause disruption in the opposition defence and then expose them wider after that.
Another opportunity then for Chris Merrick. 12 points already this afternoon. Could just ease St. Peter's out here. Struck it nicely. And it's a very good kick.
Yes, that is a very good kick indeed. And Red Territories has been in favour. There we see 20-9 to St. Peter's. Territory has been in favour of Wellington College in the second
half. Down there, Lucky, that's better. Get involved.
12 minutes remaining. It was 14-6 at half time to St. Peter's.
Crouch and hold.
It's now 20 points to 12, so no change in the margin.
Keep it down.
Merrick, not out. Wellington fullback Allen had a patchy first half. Didn't run with any great enthusiasm there, and the turnover has been forced and kicked downfield by Kane Hansey. And he's got the Wellington defence scrambling back. Good chasing through there by Asatasi. But Patrick has got back. And the ball has been secured for Wellington. Morris, the number eight, takes it on. Romato at halfback. Moresi under pressure. Struggles out of a couple of tackles. Pass threatens to go to ground. Now this is a good, solid run here from Fatoa. The kick and chase. What are his wheels like? Going back is Hawk. And there's that ruling, which I frankly don't agree with, where you are not allowed to leap on a player who's actually gone down on the ball himself, and if it's one-on-one, you have to wait to allow him to get to his feet. And really, that just makes a mockery of some very good play there from Matthew Patoa.
Yes, it is good play, and I totally agree, Steve. This is this rule needs to be looked at there. It's a one-on-one situation. The team going forward should have some advantage, and the advantage is to get the player and not allow that ball to go. Lost too many of their own throws.
Morris takes it up. Inside the 22 of St. Peter's go Wellington. Moresi. Lost forward by Allen, picked off by his opposite number, Latu, and he's going to take full toll with this kick downfield. Wellington scrambling back. It's very good work indeed from Fatoa. Now, he might run his man into position here, and that's Watt back on the field. I thought we might have seen the last of him, but they can't keep a good man down. And the pass there, not as good as Matthew Fatoa would like. But
up,
the final scrum, and referee Gutu signals full time, and it is St. Peter's College from Epsom in Auckland which takes the Adidas 2000 Schools Championship. They have beaten Wellington College 20 points to 12 after leading 14 points to 6 at half time. Just two tries in the game, the rest of the points coming from the kickers. And because they scored those two tries, certainly St. Peter's justified in celebrating this victory here today.
Well, Jeffrey, yes, a great day for St. Peter's College and the win here at Carisbrook. You must be delighted, Captain.
Yeah, I'm pretty stoked, eh? Good effort. Our guys really fought out there, and it was a great battle out there between both sides. Yes.
You've got a very big forward pack. The plan was to take it to them up front?
Yes, it was. Just keep it in the forwards, rumble them up the sideline, play the blind side, and I'm sure our guys did it well today.
And Eric Kalassi, your coach, you got a word for Big Eric?
Yeah, he's a great coach, eh? Even though he probably coaches the olden style ways, but he's good, eh? He really gets into the boys. He knows how to motivate the guys and knows how to train them hard, yes.
It's sort of like a big weight off our shoulder now, because since the Auckland Grammar game, every game from then on was a knockout situation. We had to win the first round to get so we can qualify, and then of course the top four, it'd be nice to win the Auckland Championships, which we did, yeah. And then the top four was just knockout and just week in, week out, and we're here, and it's in the end we've won it. It's great.
Terrific trophy cabinet this year. You got Moesca, got the Moesca Cup, you got the Auckland Championship, you know, the top team in Auckland, and now the Nationals. So Boy, this must be one of St. Peter's best years ever, I would have thought.
Oh, I would guess so. I don't know the history of the school, you know, beyond the last 20 years, but we're quite happy.
Eric, you enjoy coaching at this level?
Well, I do. I really do, especially if later on in life, no doubt, quite a few of these younger players will go on. And you can all sort of sit back and say, well, hey, you know, you're helping along the line somewhere. Yeah.
Lovely thought. How many will be staying on, do you think, for next year's team?
Well, I would say probably 10 will stay back. But on age-wise, it's only 3 too old, really, for next year. So it all depends on their exams. Yeah. If they do well in the exams, I can't see why they come back. Can't come back.
What an awesome unit you put it together this year, St. Peter's. I mean, right from the first day I saw them, they just had a stamp of something, an authority about them that I believed would go all the way, and they did. A fantastic unit you had.
Yeah, that comes down, I think, to discipline. I think we had a very disciplined guys, proud guys, and of course, Jeffrey, the captain, and Suwani sort of carried it on in the field. And I think that that was the end of the day that paid. We had tremendous spirit off the field and on the field, so virtually everybody is helping one another. And that's the sort of carried us right through.
I must have heard it 50 times, SPC.
Yeah.
Spirit, pride, commitment.
That's right.
Marvellous that you're able to incorporate the letters of the school into a slogan like that. And they lived up to it.
Yes. Well, I would say that quite a few old boys would be happy with the result. And it's from them that virtually the team played for, and their parents, of course.
Yeah. Do we see Eric Kalassi back next year?
Oh, never know. I enjoy it. And that's what all life's about, I suppose. Enjoy what you're doing, and if you don't, well, give it away.
St. Peter's First 15 2000. Winners of the Hibernian Shield, the Moasca Cup, the Auckland First 15 Championship, and the National Secondary Schools Champions of New Zealand. St. Peter's First 15 2000. The best of the best.